Welcome back, everyone. In this video, we are going to be dealing with two main topics. One is called the multi-programming, and the second topic is multitasking. In case of multitasking, we are taking an example of time-shared systems or time-sharing, the concept of time-sharing. Okay, so let's start with multi-programming. So multi-programming, the main idea behind multi-programming is that the CPU should never sit idle. As long as there are a few processors which demand CPU, the CPU must never sit idle. That is the main concept of multiprogramming. Now let's see how this multiprogramming is implemented. So since there are many number of processors, all those processors, they reside in a place in the disk which is called a job pool. So job pool, it has all the processors which demand CPU. So all the processes which require CPU, they are stored in a place called job pool in the disk that is secondary memory. And from those processes which are present in the job pool, a few processors are brought into the main memory. Since the main memory is not as large as the disk, only a few processes can be brought from the disk into the main memory. And those processes are selected by various scheduling algorithms called disk scheduling algorithms. So based on a few disk scheduling algorithms, whatever disk scheduling algorithm we use, based on that algorithm, a few processes from this job pool are brought into this main memory. Only the processes which are present in the main memory can get the CPU. That is, they can get executed. So the first step is to bring the processes from the job pool into the main memory. Once the processes are in the main memory, the operating system, it selects a process from the main memory so that it can gain the CPU for execution. So first, all processes are present in the job pool. Then disk scheduling algorithms are implemented to select a few processes from the job pool, and they are brought into the main memory. From the main memory, one process is selected by the operating system. And after the operating system selects one process, the operating system provides access to the CPU for that particular process. Now the process has gained CPU, so it carries on its execution. So CPU is now performing its job, that is, it is executing that process. And the process, while executing, it might require some IO devices. So now the process, say process has completed some portion of its execution, and it now requires IO to complete or to progress its execution. So it then goes, it wants IO. So, and let's say that the IO is currently being used by some other process. So since the IO, it requires IO for any progress to be seen in its execution, it requires IO, but the IO is now, input output device is now not free. So that process must wait for this input output device to get free. So once it becomes free, the process can access those IO devices. But since the IO devices are not free, the process is now currently in a waiting state. In case of non-multi-programming system, the CPU sits idle in this waiting period. That is, until and unless the IO device becomes free, the process keeps on waiting. So process would be waiting until the IO becomes free. And along with the process, the CPU also sits idle. So in case of non-multi-programmed system, CPU, it completes entirely the process and then goes back to some other process. But in case of multi-programming system, that is not the case. In this period of waiting, when the process, say P1, is waiting for IO device, the OS, it switches back to the memory, main memory, and it selects some other process, say P2. Now P2 is selected by the operating system. P1 is still waiting for IO device. Now it selects P2, and whatever execution is required by P2, CPU does that particular job. So now CPU is not idle. In this period of waiting, when the process P1 waits for IO, CPU does not sit idle, rather it performs the execution of P2. Now again, if P2 requires IO, it will also have to wait, and CPU would revert back to main memory, and it would operating system, the system would select some other process, say P3, and the CPU would not sit idle, but it'll perform the execution of P3. In this way, CPU never sits idle unless and until there are no processes in the main memory. Once process P1 gains the IO and it finishes all the IO activities, it regains back the CPU. So after it finishes the IO operation, it regains back CPU, and the CPU continues the execution of process P1. In this way, unless and until there are no processes in the main memory, CPU never sits idle. That is the main concept of multiprogramming. Thus, multiprogramming, the main advantage of multiprogramming, we can say that it helps in maximizing the CPU utilization. So that's it with the multiprogramming. Now let's have a look at a new concept that is called time sharing. Time sharing, it can be considered as a logical extension to that of multiprogramming. In case of multiprogramming, the main idea was to increase or maximize the CPU utilization. But in case of time sharing, the main idea is to minimize the response time. We'll talk about this. So the main idea of multitasking or time sharing system is that we have many users which are they are at some terminals, say T1, T2, T3, T4. So we have a large number of users who are located at some portion, at some part called the terminals. Okay, so there is one computer system, and all these users located at the terminals T1 to say T4, they want to access this single computer system. The main idea of how they access, that is how these users access this computer system, it depends on a concept called the time quantum. So the main idea of time sharing is to allot each of these users at each of these terminals, to allot each of them a time slot called time quantum. So say this user wants to access computer system. All these are in a queue. All the processors want to access the computer system, and all these processors, they are given with some time, which is called some equal sized time slot is allotted to each of those processes or each of those users, which is called the time slot. So once the time slot of this gets over, the computer system, it releases this process, and it goes to this process, and this user can now access the computer system. Again, once the time quantum expires for this, it'll go back to this, and now this can access the computer system. Again, once the time quantum for this gets expired, it'll go back to this, and now this particular terminal can access the computer system. Once the time quantum for this expires, it can go back to T1. T1 again gains the access to the computer system. To have a bit of clear understanding, we can compare a time sharing system to a wall clock. So in case of wall clock, all the numbers on the clock, they can be considered to be the tasks, and the center, or you can say the hand. So the hand is access to CPU. So hand, it determines the access to CPU, and the numbers which are present on the wall clock, they represent the tasks. So let us take that example and have a bit of clear understanding on what time sharing system is. Okay, so let us take an example where we have six users, and all these six users are trying to get an access to this shared CPU. Each of these users, they have their own programs which require the use of the CPU for its execution. So the time sharing system, it starts with some random user, say we start with user 1. So now the user 1, it is given a time quantum, say TQ is equal to, let's say it is, for an example sake, let's consider it as 1 second. It will not be 1 second, it will be It'll be lower than 1 second, but for our sake, for an example sake, we'll consider the time quantum to be 1 second. Now, user one has a time quantum of 1 second. That means to say that user one can access this CPU for 1 second and it can continue the execution for only 1 second. As soon as 1 second or the time quantum elapses, the CPU, it switches to user two. So now this user would have to wait for its next turn. And again, once the time quantum for user 2 finishes, CPU would be allotted to user 3, and this would have to wait for its next turn. And in this way, this keeps on going. But the main idea here is that the time quantum is so low that the switching from one user to another user is, you can say it as negligible. We can say that the user never feels that there is any time delay in its execution. Rather, he feels that the execution was going in a smooth manner without any jitters in the time. So user one, it gets a time quantum of say 1 second. And then as soon as 1 second gets over, user two gets the access to CPU. And then after 1 second, user three, after 1 second, user four, and it goes on. But it's not 1 second. It'll be very less so that the user feels that it has a dedicated CPU for itself. So it seems like each user has its own CPU. So we can say that even though there is one CPU, all of these users, they feel that they have their own CPU. That is the main idea of time quantum or time sharing system, where each user is supplied with a time slot of very less value. And as soon as that time slot expires, the CPU gets allocated to the next user in the queue, or you can say it gets allocated to the next user. And you can see that it works similar to that of a clock, where all the numbers, they represent the users or the tasks which are to be performed, and the hand here, it represents the allocation of CPU. So that's it regarding the time sharing system. Thank you for watching.